Well, as was mentioned by Amartya Sen at the annual lecture of WIDER, one of the big issues facing development, and particularly in Africa, is energy and its importance in driving industrialization and structural change. And energy now is very much tied with climate policy as well. So as we look at Africa, we have two issues we're addressing: is how do we supply the energy to this growing population, which already has an energy deficit, to move in poverty reduction? And then how are those energy choices impacted by climate policy, by either burning of fossil fuels, adding to the climate problem, or having green energy such as hydropower and wind and solar? How are they impacted by a changing climate, of which we will see no matter what happens now, we are going to have some change, whether it stabilizes at 2 degrees or not. So the project is, as we've seen, one of the expressions about climate change is all climate change is local. So the impacts on Southern Africa might be different than the impacts on the Congo region or East Africa. And these are all where the major hydropower developments are for Africa. So the main areas, the Zambezi has a lot of potential. The famous Grand Inga project on the Congo River, which is 40,000 megawatts, one of the largest projects in the world. Ethiopia, if they develop all of their hydro, is almost the same size as Inga. There's on the Niger Basin in Nigeria. So all of these regions are going to are responding to climate differently, the climate changes. So how stable are those energies so that they could be a background of green energy development for Africa? So one of the goals is to look in Africa's energy future, the role of hydropower, and how resilient or stable is hydropower under the future changing climates. In addition, we are looking at other renewables such as solar and wind, and we're looking at one of the big issues on solar and wind is its intermittency, where you can have it on or off in a moment if a cloud comes or the wind stops for a period or just seasonally how it blows. So part of this project is looking at how we can integrate these different renewables to increase their reliability. So putting wind with hydro to balance each other out. So we hold off the hydro when the wind is available. So looking at things in a technological side. On the other side is there's been a lot of push in Africa for regional development. We have the SADC. So that's taken on also it's in power, electric power. So we have power pools. There's a Southern African power pool, the Central African power pool, the Western African power pool, and the East African power pool. And these are all developing independently. So one of our issues is that as you bring the power pool, you can combine all those resources, particularly the renewables, and make them more reliable. So then the question has been, does it make sense for Africa as a continent to connect these power pools? So one of the questions WIDER is looking at is it worthwhile spending the money on infrastructure to connect these power pools through transmission lines, which can be very expensive? And by this connection, would this help with continental scale economic development? And then at the other side is that we want to look at that general question now in the short term. And then the bigger question is, as climate changes, one of the reasons you go for conductivity, like power pools, is that the sense that systems are out of sync. So when the Zambezi is in flood, the Congo's in drought, so they balance each other. But one of the things we're looking at from climate change is, could Africa, which is currently somewhat out of sync between north and south and east and west, which would tell you it makes sense to integrate, they may be becoming more in sync as the climate patterns change. So the likelihood of all the 7 major river basins being in drought at the same time might be something that's happening. So we're studying that biophysical part. And this is one of the really innovative and unique features of WIDER currently under FinTARP's development, is this idea of economics are being driven by biophysical and engineering systems and its infrastructure, and how do we bring them into economic development theory. And at the 30th workshop, we heard Justin Lin talk about infrastructure and the issue, and whether it's pull or push, but there's the importance of infrastructure, energy being one of the most important, and then also food and water infrastructure. And so WIDER has taken the last cycle was development under climate change, looking at the some of these struggles. And then now we focused in on the area of energy and what we're trying to do here. And what has been important is that WIDER has reached out to MIT and the Joint Program for Global Change Science and Policy to discuss how we can bring in the ideas of climate change uncertainty, the global climate change models. And one of the hallmarks of the joint program is the trying to identify this as an uncertain system. Rather than coming with detailed models, they've come with what they call semi-complex models, being able to run them a lot of time and getting looking at the uncertainties. And so under development under climate change, we looked at that from development in the Zambezi Basin. We did work in Southern Africa, also some work in Vietnam using the uncertainties that come from MIT. So it's a perfect complementarity where MIT's group has a climate science group and an economics group. And I sit in both groups. I work as in between because I have a degree in economics and in water systems. So I'm the translator. And so I'm now the bridge between MIT and WIDER, and it's a wonderful collaboration with respect on both sides and learning and growing as we come together. And we've been able to make major contributions in the field with special issues of climatic change coming out. There's a special issue on applied energy that's coming out. There is a whole host of WIDER working papers on this topic, which was one of the WIDER researchers, James Thurlow, coined it sacred. Systematic assessment of climate resilient economic development. So that's a hallmark now of the activities both at MIT and at UNU-WIDER as we work with partners. And one of the other things that we've been developing is this is not just a north-north collaboration between Helsinki and Cambridge, but it's really a triangle where we have partners in Africa. We've been working with Treasury, we're working with the UN Economic Commission for Africa, the African Climate Policy Center, even with the World Bank on some of their projects on looking on climate resilient investment, and particularly on the Africa infrastructure project that the World Bank has had. We've now joined in looking at Africa energy futures. We're looking at energy infrastructure and these decisions of how do we make these decisions and get financing, giving the risk. Rather than people being scared and running away because it's uncertain, so what do I do? There are ways to quantify those risks. There are ways to value the uncertainty and the risk that you're taking. Sometimes it's using real options or insurances. So in Africa Energy Futures, we're trying to look at and diagnose how dire, to use a term we've heard, is the climate projections for Africa? How does it affect hydropower as a renewable, wind as a renewable, and then also how does that tie in then with fossil fuels or nuclear energy to provide the backbone for African development energy? And then looking at that once academically and economically is how do we get the financing for that to happen through public-private partnerships, or is it going to be through ODA, Overseas Decision, you know, Development Assistance? How are we going to do that? So it's a comprehensive top to bottom. We have a bottom up and a top down approach looking at this to see how we can bring this important resource of energy and particularly electricity to Africa to lift them out of poverty.